So our readers this evening are Nina Mingya-Powles and Mary Jean Chan.
Hi everyone. It's amazing to be here to welcome Jenny's book into the world. Jenny's a really special friend of mine here in London since I moved here not long ago at all. I'm constantly amazed and touched by her poems. And I did a poetry school course with Jenny, that's how we kind of met. And then I creepily emailed her because I decided I wanted to be her friend. So huge congratulations. I'm just going to read a little bit from the book that Jane mentioned, Tiny Moons, which is a food memoir, or more like a food diary. Of a time when I was a student living in Shanghai. And this very short excerpt is from a chapter about Zhongzi, or Luo Mai Gai, if you're a Cantonese speaker, or if you're an English speaker. It's a sticky rice dumpling wrapped in lotus leaves. My mum always orders lo mai gai when we go for dim sum at the weekend. This kind of dumpling is wrapped in a rectangular shape rather than the Shanghainese twirly pyramid. A cloud of steam erupts in the centre of the table as my mum leans forward to tenderly unwrap them with her chopsticks. The string already cut, she folds the leaves out one by one to reveal the steaming mound of fragrant chicken and sticky rice inside. She places a morsel of chicken and rice into each of our bowls. Long before my mother and grandmother taught me how to cook, they taught me how to eat. The way my mum separates papaya seeds from the fruit's flesh with her spoon, leaving a cluster of shiny black pearls. The way my grandmother peeled speckled quail eggs. How to wrench the heads off grilled prawns and suck the flesh from the shell. How to delicately peel off the white cheek from the head of a steamed fish. How to use your chopsticks and spoon together in tandem to pull noodles from one bowl to another. How to use your back teeth to crack the shell of a lychee. I learned by watching, then copying. I'll just read a few poems now from my book that will be coming out in July with my matches, which is very exciting for me. And I sat on my phone actually. Last eclipse. She travelled alone. She crossed the mountains. She watched the landscape innocently. She supported her head on her fist. She felt strange birds in the trees. She touched an avalanche. She moved towards it. She waited without air. She sweated into the cold. She became volcanic. She heard the moon unhook from her teeth. She felt a piece of sun detach. She dissolved with blue light into orchards. She became a colour never seen. She flooded all the valleys. She sensed her last sane moment approaching. Be the last time I read this poem before the new Mulan comes out in 10 days' time. I find that a lot of my poems irrelevant. Little Warrior, or Watching Mulan in Chinese with English subtitles. 1. I remember the sound the sword made when she cut off all her hair. sound like my mother cutting fabric, those blue scissors clutched in her small hands. I remember wondering why she didn't cut from the roots, a Disney princess kneeling in the smoke-coloured dark with straight hair, thin waists, hardly any breasts. Unlike me with my thick legs and too much hair that doesn't stay. "Why don't we cut it short?" she said, and so we did. But soon it curled sideways, ungracefully caught in the wind of some perpetual hurricane. 2. When I watch Mulan in Chinese with English subtitles, I understand only some of the words. My focus shifts to certain details. How Mulan drags a very large cannon across the snow with very small wrists. How the villain has skin as dark as coal and such small eyes he has no irises. Once a guy told me mixed girls are the most beautiful because they aren't really white, but they aren't really Asian either. 3. After Mulan saves China, fireworks rain down in waves of multicolored stars. "You fight pretty good," says her boyfriend with the big American arms. I have small victories too, being kind to my body for one day, not checking my phone for your texts, walking home at night alone and not feeling lonely. 4. Why don't you ever write about yourself ever? I didn't know why either. In Chinese, one word can lead you out of the dark and then back into it in a single breath. Shut off the light, as my mother and other Chinese mothers say. Now open it. 5. When Mulan returns home, the colours change from grey, blue, green to pink, warm, yellow. There are plum blossoms floating in the stream. Her hair is still a little messy to make sure we don't forget she used to be something else. 6. When summer ended, rain poured off the edge of elevated highways and washed away the moon. I no longer have a sword, but sometimes at night I hold my keys between my fingers. I paint my lips. I draw avalanches. I light fires inside dream palaces. I cut my hair over the bathroom sink. Thank you.
So I'll just read you a few poems from my book. This first poem is, I suppose, a poem about longing to be in two places at once. Long distance. You are running on the rain-dark pavement through Sutton Park, where I am, sun. All the dehumidifiers are on in the house, no fireplaces. Some seas are colder than others, some bodies warmer. I am drinking Iron Buddha, leaves waiting for their time to blossom. It is too spring here for my own good, too much green in the salad bowl, too many stories of salvation, earlier blue beyond belief. The moon is lying on its back in my dreams. What a smile looks like. A toothbrush touches my lips. Asian steamed sea bass for dinner with white rice. Victoria Harbor was named after your queen. How many hearts in a deck of cards shuffled across two continents? I am catching a plane again tonight, thinking about the map on your neck. This next poem is called Autobiography, but it is not my own. I think in a lot of women's writing, especially BME women, there is this sense that whatever we write is sort of memoir, you know, it's sort of artlessly autobiographical, and I really wanted to challenge that. And so this poem is actually in the voice of my mother. Autobiography. My detractors think they know me, loud and always too soft-hearted. The time I purchased 50 pairs of frames from a sobbing woman whose eyewear shop was closing down. the day I lost my father and cried myself sick, until I thought I would never sing again, though music was my only love during the revolution. The time my daughter told me she was in love with a woman, and I lied and told her it would be okay. What does 3 years of famine teach a person? Nothing, except that there is such a thing as perpetual hunger, loss pounding on the windows like rain. Except that my father loved me, and that he came back as soon as he could, in the swallowtail butterfly that fluttered around the flat, in our pet papillon, in my beloved child. This next poem is one where I've tried to rhyme Cantonese with English in the two tongues. I'm sure a lot of people in the audience would perhaps appreciate that. Because in Cantonese you have 9 tones, and it occurred to me, surely there must be some sort of sounds that will rhyme with English words. Speaking in tongues. Mother says, fun lay. Poet says, behave. Mother says, sing scene. Poet says, moonbeam. Mother says, separation of voice. Poet says, behave, moonbeam. Mother says, the way you ask the moon to behave is transgressive, not Chinese. Poet says, my voice is a splinter. Teen Hay, these days, I can only speak about the weather with a tongue splitting, spitting monosyllabic blue or gray. But did you know, I've discovered a secret, that half of my words have been kept like a key under a plant which my mother waters daily and is something that grows. Those beautiful ghosts, they seem to say, Ying Dan Ne. And that last phrase means, I recognize you. I think I'll read 2 short poems now to finish off. This is actually a poem I wrote back in 2015, and in a way it was sort of how I was thinking about becoming a poet, and it sort of takes a lifetime, doesn't it? So this poem is called One Breath. I have been hearing it everywhere these days, that sudden song burst from the throats of the still too young, their world too tragic for silence, leaving them no choice but to grip their mother's arms as if touch were breath, as if no sorrow could bear this moment when a cry becomes the world, the song that might cost them their lives unraveling from their throats, a spool of flung thread rising, a blown bubble till it bursts, releasing its fury into gasps, yawps, howls, all the sounds a body makes when it becomes its own instrument, rehearsing the songs it has learnt across the centuries, forgetting how young it still is, how long moss takes to green, how much ripening awaits. And I'll end with the final poem in the book. What my mother, a poet, might say. Be a river, she might say. Be the water that flows over and under and along, so you will never hurt from sharp things. Be the eyes that glow, be the body whose scent and sound attract all the colors of the night. Be the rainbow that leaps into that cleansed dome of sky after storms erupt in the breasts of millions. Be the tree that praises even when the cacophony of tractors drown out its hymns. Be the roots that seep through stone. Be the echo of your blood, song of your bones.
There she is, dusting again the antiques called Chinese goods with a gaimo sole, blue porcelain, milky snuff bottles, small ivory animals. When she speaks, she fills the room with her thick northern accent, charms the tourists with that lilt. Everything comes from the news agents, green spot juice, ding ding candies, and worship goods. No metro yet, so we go to work by bus. From a counter of calligraphy's grows, I ask her out. You look just like the singer, Ha Xiu Sing, Dan Summer. I'm flattered. roasting chicken wings in Taitan. We hum Simon and Garfunkel's America the year she turns 18. And when John Lennon comes to town, we wear ombre sunglasses and trumpet-shaped jeans. I have nothing to offer, not a car or a flat, but I've made her cassette tapes of all our favorite Beatles and Garfunkel tracks. Her mother hates everything, with hobbies. My father worships Mao. We are young. Who can stop us? So we marry the following year in spring. A simple wedding. Geng cha, gao bui zao, and kowtow to our parents in a tea house without a gown. What is the difference between each unit? Chinese classifiers. How do I explain the rules for units? They are spontaneous. Chen for furniture and flat surfaces like A4 paper, while Z is for animals and watches. Lup for small grains, rice, sand, pearls, or stars. Til for anything slender, from a noodle to a river. You ask why is it Yatil legislation? Why Yatze egg? Why Yatou movie when Tou means a rabbit? How come Gan is the unit for a room, but it is also good for a school? Why is Beijing more polluted than London and Hong Kong different from the mainland? How much freedom have you got there? I tell you, I don't know. Someone handed us the rules. So this poem is one of my favorites. It's very hard to get anyone interested in this poem because I send it to magazines and no one wants to take it.
I'm so glad I don't think about it.
I should have read more Chinese literature, but this is like Fa Jin's books are one of those that really touch my heart. And I think, although it is sort of a critique on futurism, it's back then, it's a story about how young people sort of fight for their dreams. But I still think it has a lot of relevance to us today. And I really doubted whether it is actually futurism that they're fighting against or Fa Jin has some other meanings. So it starts with a quotation, but actually, I should read the annotated English version, maybe. So actually, there's the epigraph. It comes from Fa Jin's family, like one of the novels that he wrote. For dreams will not desert their followers. As long as you do not give up, you will bask in the glory of your dreams. That home in your book, Ga, with its golden roof, was the first warning. A beautiful mansion in the name of Confucian living, Ga, where everyone has to be perfect as a porcelain face. In the embroidered robes, the parents sit in Qing Dynasty chairs made of rosewood, virtuous statues, giving daily lessons of foreknows to the young. Fei lai mat si, fei lai mat ting, fei lai mat yin, fei lai mat dong. Happy are those who stay silent and notice nothing, feel nothing. Unhappy are those who are young at heart. Cursed are those who battle with the giant. 1923, when you left Sichuan, your jia, what were you thinking? Ga is home or family or none of those. But Shanghai was not big enough for you. 4 years later, you boarded a ship for Paris, France, a paradise for dreamers. In the Latin Quarter, you wrote in the day, in a flat that reeked of onions, and studied French at night. Chuguo, a sad word, a brave word. Who but an exiled youth could write what you did? Who could question our fathers? We are all leaving our fathers, fathers who feed the family, who appoint wives for young men, fathers who put duties on our shoulders, fathers who rule our land, gods in our universe. We are always leaving our fathers. To read Ga in Oxford, 70 years away from the fresh ink of those pages, I see students cycle to their colleges made of dreams and sandstone, To the world, they are defiant to change. Just like your wife in your book, their strands of hair catch the gold in the sun. So when I was my friends actually hired someone to do this with it for extraordinary amount of money. Naming the sheep ear babies is to use luck to herd them back to Mother Nature where they belong. Bless the sheep babies with ideal grants of rolling hills, a loving farm, haze, beans, tender grass. Respect their vegetarian diets. Born to graze on endless pastures, add a sense of movement to their names, and set them free with the brushstrokes of leaps and jumps of galloping horses. Do not bring them anywhere near the animals they fear, cows, dogs, and mice, or their health will deteriorate. Sheep babies don't cope well with stress, so spare them from words that suggest yoke or anything to do with the heart. Avoid all ominous symbols of altars, knives, hanging, ceremonial fabrics, creatures used for sacrifice. They say sheep ear is not particularly good for having babies. But if you WhatsApp me at fengshuipro338@yahoo.com.hk, your aspirations for your precious one, stunning beauty, stable career, or to fetch a golden turtle husband, I will come up with the luckiest name commensurate with your feelings. Cunning Chinese people.